How's everyone doing? Good? All right, cool. Am I talking too loud? No? Okay, it's just very echoey. Yeah, thanks to Triple Canopy for compelling me to do this because, you know, I completely misunderstood what this was supposed to be. So Zach, my former pupil, and I went back and forth with Alex for quite a while, and I completely misunderstood. For whatever reason, I think based on an email from last year, I thought that this was a live instantiation of a music magazine. And so I pitched, basically this is like a live listicle you'll be experiencing. So these are just sort of formative experiences of concerts. There won't actually be that much listening, I have to say, because I don't know. There's only so much of some of these bands you could listen to. So, this will just be a series of formative concert experiences, probably all crammed between the years 1992 and 1998. First concert. I enrolled late in high school and ended up in a remedial English class. It might not have been remedial. I think the term had already fallen out of use by that point in the 90s. But given the high baseline of achievement at our Silicon Valley High School, it might as well have been. Our teacher was young and inexperienced, and she wanted to be liked, which meant she had no capacity to control us. A group of kids just practiced fly girl routines from In Living Color in the back the whole time. I sat off to the side with Carl, a short, scratchy-voiced Chinese kid who was extremely into Iced Tea and Public Enemy, and Lawrence, this tall white kid who was always drawing heavy metal logos on everything. Lawrence had blonde hair and blue eyes, a mischievous smile. He was tall in a way that seemed neither gangly nor athletic. Where Carl was showy and aggressive about his enthusiasms, Lawrence was quiet and cool. He often had his electric guitar with him, which he'd polish and clean while our teacher taught us the difference between prepositions and nouns. Lawrence's father ran a music shop in town where people took lessons, rented flutes or guitars. It was his family business, which is why he was so good at the guitar. He talked to me in a way where he assumed I understood what he was talking about. Soon I started drawing the Slayer logo on my binder too, even though I had no idea what they sounded like, although I later discovered that they sounded exactly like what you'd think a band called Slayer sounded like. I didn't understand why he was talking to me and Carl all the time instead of the girls practicing their routines in the back. One day, he leaned to me and said he wrote Auschwitz on his guitar in Sharpie in the style of the Metallica logo. Only his old man got pissed and had him varnish it off. That sucks, man, I said, having no idea what he was talking about. I'd never heard the word Auschwitz and assumed it was a band his dad didn't like. I'm not sure Lawrence really understood who he was saying either. Lawrence and a couple underclass stoners volunteered to play at homecoming. Lawrence played guitar and sang, and they covered Jerry Was a Race Car Driver by Primus, which was a little weird since Primus was led by a bass player. So I'm gonna play you songs throughout this next, however long this takes, but very few of them will be the actual clips I'm talking about, so. Instead, they're taken from late night TV.
Yes, with their first major label album. I feel like Casey Kasem. By that I mean small and in a turtleneck. They're about to start a European tour in Europe with Rush. Now Rush is from like
Canada.
Weren't they?
Does anyone know who this is?
Weren't they like LBJ's favorite
Dennis
band?
Miller.
They used to pick them up by their ears. Here performing Jerry Was a Race Car Driver. Yeah, Primus!
The song that wouldn't die.
Driver, he drove so goddamn fast.
Primus fans here? Sort of a loss to time, I would say. Even back then, I feel like the hair on the back of my neck would stand up when that song would come on, just because it's so strange. And if you were to watch the video, the way they dance around, there are clearly people with no sense of self-consciousness. It's an absolutely ridiculous song by one of the weirdest bands to make it onto MTV at a time when it was actually quite normal for weird bands to be on MTV. And they were from somewhere in the Bay Area, a couple hours away from us, which made them feel local. And for a moment, Lawrence and his friends became Primus. They were our local heroes brought proximate. Lawrence contorted his voice to sound all cartoonish and funny, like Les Claypool. Then they did a Metallica song, and Lawrence, who'd always seemed really sweet and soft-spoken, made his voice deep and gravelly. The guitar parts were nothing to him. He just blazed away with this cocky grin. I'd seen clips on PBS of Beatlemania or screaming kids throwing themselves at Elvis. I saw pictures in magazines of people clawing at Morrissey at Smith's concerts and bringing him flowers. But I'd never seen someone so thoroughly transformed before my eyes. I don't remember who won homecoming, but everyone in that moment realized that Lawrence was actually hot. He was a rock god, he was tall in a very handsome, actually quite dangerous way. He still sat with me and Stan, but now the fly girls would come by and talk to him and ask to touch the strings of his guitar. I ended up in accelerated English the next year. Every now and then, for years to come, I would drive by his family's shop, which rebranded a few times. Over the years, it slowly lost its grip on the market as more immigrants settled in the area, starting their own specialized centers for violin or piano. Kids wanted to be DJs, not start rock bands. Fewer people needed guitar lessons or practice space. And I looked it up recently, the music shop in the 7-Eleven next door, where the goth and heavy metal kids used to smoke, are now a South Asian preschool. First actual concert. I begged my parents to let me go see Suede, a group I was obsessed with, largely because I did not know, thank you to whoever expressed enthusiasm there. I think one of the reasons I love them so much is because I didn't know at the time that they were copying other bands, like the Smiths or David Bowie or Queen. I thought that they were just sort of the only band that had ever sounded like this. I would read British music magazines with these huge spreads showing people tearing the lead singer's clothes off, not knowing that these photos were essentially reenactments of what people had done to Morrissey and the Smiths years earlier. Suede was one of the biggest bands in the UK, and it was only a matter of time before they dominated the US too. Or so I told everyone in my driver's ed class as I made them listen to Animal Nitrate. From when they were playing in England, which is why people were so stoked. So they were playing at the Warfield in San Francisco, and my friend Lee, who was British, and thus the coolest person I'd ever met in my life, was going. Her brother drove us, though I don't think he said anything to me the entire time. This made him seem even cooler than Lee. The fact that he could spend many hours with me and only communicate through the tape he was playing, the wordless offering of a cigarette, which I was too awed to take from him. That night is when I learned how I wanted to stand. We got there early and leaned along this railing that divided the venue into two. I tried to affect the same passionately disinterested slouch as Lee and her brother. It sort of rationalized the fact that I had bad posture. I imagined holding my cigarette the way everyone around me did, though I would not actually smoke a cigarette for 3 more years. I learned that you could shout to pop stars by their first name in a way that didn't seem hysterical or desperate, as though you knew them personally and they wanted to hear from you. That there was a method of swaying coolly to music, to commune with it in a manner that was liquid and lazy. That night, the opening band was a little-known Irish band called the Cranberries. They had a minor hit on college radio, which I remember liking until it got overplayed. I remember how quiet they were. Someone near me, not Lee or her brother, who were cool, whispering that Dolores O'Riordan was adorable in this admiring, protective way.
Yeah, I have no idea. They've done an album. They haven't even had like a single or anything out yet.
But they're good.
But they're good. So keep an eye out for them.
Yeah,
Shark Boy.
Yeah, it's kind of like Velvet Underground or Nico or something like that. It's like, you know, quite bleak, but quite beautiful. It's great.
It's got a brilliant voice. Well, it's great to have you guys down here tonight. It's Suede, of course. Live in the studio.
This
got Brett and Matt and
my
Simon
first radio
here.
Memory of Suede
and,
was the big interview
tonight,
on the radio.
Doing an acoustic set at Tower at Market Street, right near Castro, the Tower record store out there on Market Street. Make sure you stop on by and check out their live performance tonight.
It's not the last time you'll be hearing this DJ's tonight. Voice today.
The Cranberries. Thanks a lot for coming down to the radio station.
Thanks a lot.
You want to play a song, another one? Get one more on?
Oh,
yes.
She's not saying.
All right.
Ready here.
There you go. They're from Limerick, Ireland, not England, like some bonehead said earlier in the show.
This is John Stewart.
Like some idiot who has no idea between England and Ireland.
Drink
I apologize for that. Limerick, Ireland, they're going to do a great song right now. They're on the road with Duran Duran, their major label debut. Everybody else is doing it, so why can't we? It's about to go gold. Here to sing Linger. Please welcome the Cranberries, everybody.
Stuck in our heads for the rest of this day. So that was from the short-lived John Stewart show, not the one on Comedy Central. He had a talk show before that. People freaked out when the Cranberries played, even though a lot of people didn't know who they were that night. And I found this deeply annoying, almost offensive. I preferred Suede. That's why I thought we were all in the room that day. And I looked around the venue in shock after the Cranberries finished, and people were aglow. Like, some people left, like they'd seen enough. And after a short break, Suede came on. I was completely enraptured. I knew all the words to all their songs, which I mouthed to myself quietly, swaying coolly. But I could feel that drop-off in energy in the room, even though this was only the first actual concert I'd been to. And I realized that the Cranberries had essentially completely sort of dominated. They'd won the night. If you recall, if you heard John Stewart introducing them, by the end of that year, they were opening for Duran Duran. They were no longer opening for Suede. And I remember thinking that night, like, had I chosen the wrong favorite? Was I not apprehending the emergence of some world historical band before my eyes? I should have felt total ecstasy, but doubt gnawed at my edges. And to add to that night's disappointment, Suede was not selling any t-shirts, which in the beginning was probably 20% of the reason why I wanted to go to any concerts in the first place. That year, during that tour, the Cranberries slowly began winning over Suede's crowds, and by the end of the tour, the openers were getting the loudest applause. And if you go online, some people even mistakenly remember it as a co-headlining show, not a Suede show that the Cranberries open. First concert t-shirt. Now, concert t-shirts are where I learned about the concept of stolen valor. It's a trophy and a beacon to others, an invitation to ask the wearer or shower them with flattery. It's the sign of a devotee that might also out you as a total poser. People used to wear them to school the next day, so they still smelled kind of industrial and smoky. You had to, or else it was completely meaningless to get one in the first place. Nothing depicted just how chill your parents were, too, than if you showed up at school on a weekday with evidence that you had gone to a concert on a school night. If you didn't wear it the next day, you might as well never wear it at all, as the pack moved quickly to whatever was next. So all summer in 1992, I studied the lineup of Lollapalooza, which was this big package tour. I wrote it down, but I could recite the lineup without having written it down. It was Lush, the Jesus and Mary Chain, Pearl Jam, Soundgarden, Ice Cube, Ministry, and the Red Hot Chili Peppers. And I would study the lineup and try and figure out how I would allocate $40 on two t-shirts. My friends and I got to the Shoreline Amphitheater in Mountain View as soon as it opened. And Lollapalooza, it's sort of like a precursor to all festivals, but there was this sort of social activist bent to it where there were all these like different nonprofits and NGOs that would set up booths. And I was a total mark. I took every flyer and button and leaflet from all the people, Planned Parenthood, Rock the Vote, PETA. Anyone who had a booth, I would go up and talk to them, you know, and sort of get whatever I could. I explored the side stage where more obscure bands played. There was like a bungee jumping thing, which I looked at. I even peeked inside the medical tent just to see what was going on in there. I saw Ice-T just hanging out, and I thought it was amazing to be somewhere where someone like Ice-T would just hang out. So when it came time to buy a t-shirt, I had to choose very wisely. I bought a Lollapalooza one. It seemed great value because it featured all the band's logos. And while my favorite bands that day were probably the Jesus and Mary Chain and the Red Hot Chili Peppers, I figured I might see those bands again someday. So I didn't want to get too, you know, I wanted something a little more unusual. I wanted an item of clothing and therefore an identity I could grow into. So it was down to Soundgarden and Ministry.
Did you get a chance to see any of the other bands play at all?
I've seen everybody except Rush so far.
Who's the best? Who do you like the best?
Soundgarden.
Who do you like second best?
Soundgarden, I think, was good. They came in like a close second to us, but...
I just spent the last 10 weeks looking at Europeans, so I gotta come home and see everybody. It kind of looked like family. You're all invited for Thanksgiving. This song is called Outshine.
Thank you.
Okay, so I chose Soundgarden. I'm still not sure why. I had heard that the Seattle band got their name from a poem by William Blake. Something, I think. So I didn't know who that was at the time either. But I knew that I should know who William Blake was, and I figured I could tell my parents Soundgarden had something to do with poetry, therefore school. So I bought the shirt. I listened to their first two albums, but wasn't sure if I wanted actually this level of commitment. But you know, as I was standing there in line, there were too many kids right before me who got the ministry shirt, which prominently featured the number 69. And the combination of these two factors nudged me towards Soundgarden. So the guy hands me the shirt. It had this circle of raised middle fingers. And as a result of this puffy ink they'd used for the black on black print and the off-brand TV t-shirt, it wasn't like Gildan or Champion or Riddell or anything. It was misshapen and boxy as soon as he handed it to me, and I felt instant regret. I rarely wore it because as much as I tried, I just couldn't get into Soundgarden. And even though I'd pull it out of my dresser, it always seemed as this possible future that never arrived for me. All right, first concert with actual adults, third concert t-shirt. Back then, you had to be sure you were at one of those big chain record stores the moment they opened to ensure that you could buy prized concert tickets. The morning Lollapalooza tickets had gone on sale, my friends and I had showed up early at our local warehouse and waited alongside dozens of other teenagers, all there for the same reason. But at the front of the line were two older people, a preppy couple. They were probably just in their 20s. They looked so clean compared to all of us, and thus very uncool. And nobody wanted to talk to them. And as the store opened, I finally was like, "So are you guys going to Lollapalooza too?" And the guy laughed at me like I was a child. "No," he said, "we're going to see Guar." If you don't know who Guar is, they are a scatological thrash metal band known for stage sets that feature a lot of fake blood and piss. And it was my first glimpse at an approach to adulthood that was different from every model of adulthood I'd ever seen before. As an only child, my world came into focus through my older cousins, who are sort of like the closest older people to me. I never thought about how much older Eugene was. Eugene's not here, right? Okay. Just that he was at least one full level of schooling older than me. As in, when I was in middle school, he was already in college. He and his brother Eric were raised in Connecticut, near the town made famous by Lyme disease. In the summer of 1993, my parents took a trip to the East Coast, ostensibly to look at colleges I would end up not applying to. And Eugene, home from Carnegie Mellon, tagged along when we went to New York for a couple days. There's a free daytime concert in Central Park, NRBQ, Pear Ubu, and They Might Be Giants. Eugene wanted to go too and offered to chaperone me. He assured my parents it would be fine, it'd still be bright outside by the time we got back to the hotel. I remember nothing about the music except that it was loud and the thrill I felt walking toward the stage, which with hundreds of other people who decided in a city with a lot to do that this is what they wanted to do that day. One day I'd be taller as well, not just looking at the elbows of adults. I would be the type of person who went to concerts. They Might Be Giants were elastic and poppy. I understood their appeal, and I bought a t-shirt, as I'd seen some kids in orchestra with them. I left way too much time between songs. All right.
They're a very talented musical duo from Brooklyn, New York. This new CD is called Apollo 18.
They'll be performing
July 8th at Ventura Theater in Ventura, California, and August 5th at the Beacon Theater in New York. I'll be joined now by special guest singer Sid Straw, along with Branford and the Tonight Show Brass. Please welcome They Might Be Giants.
Thank you.
feel like TikTok could do a lot with They Might Be Giants, actually. If you've listened to any of the other songs, they're very kind of quirky and meme-y. Anyhow, I got the shirt. It had their logo on it like 10 times, which also seemed like really good value. I didn't like NRBQ that much, mostly because they had their boisterous, long-haired, middle-aged fans. And then Pear Ubu really perplexed me. I knew they were punks from Cleveland, but they didn't seem like, they didn't have the type of straightforwardly confrontational music that I associated with punks from my high school. They seemed to just be generating all this extraneous clanging noise. Also, their lead singer looked like one of these wizened old people I knew from debate camp. He didn't really conform to any contemporary notion of cool. And I found him a bit scary, actually. After the sing-song quirk of They Might Be Giants and the pro forma rock moves of NRBQ. But all these grown-ups, they were probably just people in their late 20s, now that I think about it, were very into Pear Ubu, dancing wildly to their massive, clunky sounds. And I was fascinated by how people responded to this music, which I suddenly took to be deep and complex, and something I was not yet ready for. As I listened, I felt a sense of shock and discomfort, but also awe. One day, I believed, Pear Ubu would make sense to me. And this was a thrilling feeling, the discovery of this new horizon. First concert with parents, which was also the first time I realized, actually, this is not the first time, one of many times I realized I was no true artist. Sometime around when Radiohead was set to release The Bends, I needed to renew my passport. The nearest office was in San Francisco, about an hour from our home, so my parents picked a random date and told my teachers they'd be pulling me from classes. I was a senior in my spring semester heading to Berkeley, so attendance was largely inconsequential. The passport office was in the Embarcadero, near a fancy dim sum spot where we'd eat lunch. The night before, I heard on the radio that Radiohead would be playing a noontime concert for Live 105, our local modern rock station, steps from the restaurant. Now, noontime concerts, I feel like, are this bygone relic of the radio era, maybe the word of mouth era. In San Francisco, Live 105 would always have them in Justin Herman Plaza, to catch the lunchtime Embarcadero crowd. And this was 1993, so Radiohead was known for Creep, but you could be forgiven for thinking they were this one-hit wonder, and most people would just go back to work after hearing Creep. But the band did not think this. We got my passport renewed early, and I persuaded my parents to eat sandwiches on the plaza instead of dim sum. And I positioned myself right in front. Radiohead showed up. A bunch of them were wearing black, even though it was bright and sunny. And Tom York flailed around like he was infected with some itch he couldn't scratch. I was just a few feet away from him, totally mesmerized, an impressionable teen. The way he seemed to stretch and angle himself through every word, lyrics I didn't, and to this day, do not really understand. It persuaded me that he was as deep as he believed. He had weaponized his awkwardness. I could never do anything like that. I felt embarrassed to be standing outside in the sun, cautiously swaying along to these songs, not wanting to call attention to myself in the light of day. I watched York and Johnny Greenwood, who seemed to have a haircut designed for him to be bent over his guitar, and I felt like these were people who probably had no idea what it meant to feel shame or self-consciousness. Now, years later, I realized that multiple people had recorded the whole show on camcorder. The camera swings from the band through the crowd. It's so bright that everything just seems to fade out in spots. It feels both bigger and smaller than I remember. I've tried to find myself in the crowd, but I can't, or I refuse to try too hard because it would just be too awkward to see myself like that. And I've recorded Tom York talking about the weather at this show a bunch of times, so.
This one's for all the people there on their lunch break. Brighten your day. Thought they could get much brighter, really. All right, then. All right. Anyone can play guitar?
It's probably hard for you to tell, but he just keeps talking about how sunny it is and how miserable he is in the sun, so...
This is a song about meaning it or not meaning it. We don't have to mean it all the time. This isn't a Pepsi advert. Thank you very much. This is a song to eat the sandwiches.
He said, this is a song for eating sandwiches. The person who yelled identifies herself on the YouTube clip. She's like, that's me yelling at the beginning of Fake Plastic Trees. No, High and Dry. What song is this? High and Dry, sorry. They sound alike. All right, I think it's that time.
It's that time of the day. What time's that? Creek time of the day.
Yeah, at the beginning he says, it's that time, and then suggesting how miserable they were to be playing the song. It was cool to see them.
That was an explosion of musical energy. Radiohead, let's hear it one more time for us.
Okay, so, you could watch the whole thing if you want, but that was the DJ, I think his name is Steve Master, saying, an explosion of musical energy, Radiohead. And I think part of when, at this time that I'm describing, when you just had less access to things, you would remember things like that. You would sort of memorize the weird ways people would talk as they were introducing songs. I became sort of fascinated as I was writing my memoir about sort of whether or not there were other concerts I'd been to that had been documented in this way, and surprisingly very few of them, but there were all of these tapes of... home base, this place where raves in Oakland used to take place. And it would just be someone walking from room to room at these raves in Oakland in 1998. And I think the audio quality is incredible. Like, there's just so much presence of sound. When you're at a club, at a rave, there's a physical presence of sound, right? But to listen to it, not from a soundboard, not from a mixing board, but to hear it this way through someone's camcorder, you feel that distance as well, the sort of cavernous nature of those old warehouses. But there's also this space there's also this space within the sound to roam, even if you weren't actually there. So I would spend a lot of time watching these old camcorder sort of the sort of camcorder footage of people walking around these old raves that I went to around this time. So my first obsession, sometime in 1992, my high school debate partner Harish and I became obsessed with this band called Sloan. They sounded a lot like Nirvana and My Bloody Valentine, only they were far more obscure than these two bands and therefore perfect to claim as my new favorite. They were from Halifax, Nova Scotia. And for a time, there was no place on earth to me more exotic than Halifax, Nova Scotia. I did school presentations on Canadian things just so I could say the name aloud, Halifax, Nova Scotia. Harish knew a lot about the internet, which meant very little to anyone back then. But he eventually found a message board where Canadian college students would gossip about Sloan. In those days, there was a vibrant tape trading world, and we had very little to offer other than concerts taped off our local modern rock station. But Harish convinced someone to send us a recording of something called Sloan at Brunswick Hall from CBC Stereo, November 5th, 1994, plus extras. The message board member who taped the concert broadcast for Harish remains a hero to us, Shant Pelly. I've never forgotten this guy's name. We listened to it obsessively. We memorized all the banter, what the announcers said as they cut to commercial, the brief interview about gelato. We knew to be ready when one side of the tape ended and we needed to flip to the other side. It was like this panoramic glimpse into what it would be like to go to Halifax, Nova Scotia to be college students, to live somewhere incredibly cool where you could listen to the CBC every day, not just on cassette.
For Hot Ticket, which you will be hearing a bit later tonight. Right now, I've got Jay Ferguson from Sloan on the line from his home in Halifax. Hi, Jay.
Hello.
How are you doing?
I'm okay.
I've got the twice removed the CD cover in front of me. Yellow shirt, is that you?
Yeah.
Okay, that's good to know. You sort of look...
Yeah, well, it was and just... I think Chris and Patrick started a little slapping match or something, so... I don't know if that'll exactly...
We would listen to this interview like it was like Stairway to Heaven and just memorize parts of Jay Ferguson telling this CBC interviewer about what it felt like to put out an album that very few people actually bought. Now, I dreamed of seeing them live. The problem was that something prevented them from going on large-scale tours of the U.S. The rumor was that there was some work permit issue, and they could only cross the border for a couple days at a time, meaning they could only pile into a van and play the East Coast, since it was close to Halifax, but never in California. But sometime in 1996, Sloan were picked to open for the singer Matthew Sweet on his U.S. tour, meaning they would be playing a show in Los Angeles. I flew down from Berkeley and stayed with Casper, who was in film school at Loyola Marymount. He was more into Maya Deren and Noy than Sloan, but we understood one another as fellow travelers, since we both were very into things. We ate at the Cheesecake Factory before the show. I think Casper meant this ironically, but I thought it was the best meal I'd ever had in my life. We got there early to the theater, and I was one of the only people there for Sloan, except for three women around my age who were apparently fans too. We all stood close to the stage as Jay, Chris, Patrick, and Andrew got ready. But instead of joining up, we became rivals. They sang along as loudly as possible, oftentimes drowning out the band. And they danced in unison, throwing their arms around as though they'd practiced these dance routines set to Sloan B-sides. I kept my hands in my pockets and pogoed around, moshing and crashing into them, screaming for them to stop singing so loudly.
Tonight's Hot Ticket concert is Sloan, recorded in their hometown of Halifax. And according to Sloan's guitar player, Jay Ferguson, who I spoke with earlier tonight, it was one of those really out-of-control shows. So he just said, you know, get the visuals of just basically chaos and anarchy going in your mind. It was 3 weeks ago tonight that the Hot Ticket recording crew headed out to Brunswick Hall in downtown Halifax and braved the all-ages crowd to capture the exuberant atmosphere that was the homecoming concert for Jay, Chris, Patrick, and Andrew, also known as Sloan. That is tonight's Hot Ticket.
Hi, this is Patrick from Sloan, live in Halifax, Nova Scotia.
You could tell how friendly they are, these people.
Tonight's show is an all-ages show, as most of our shows in Canada are. We would try to do that in the States as well. But it's a little bit tougher, but mainly all ages shows are good because when I was 15, 16 years old and a cool band came to town, I couldn't go to see them because it was in a bar. You had to be 19 years old or whatever to get in, so we try to do our best to, cater to all our audience, not just the select few.
Hey, Halifax, it's good to be back. Sorry we missed the old pop explosion again, but hey, we have business. And this next song we did on a split single with Eric Strip. And they did our song and we did their song. This is our song that we wrote. This is called Lang Blang.
When we're obsessed with an artist, is it because we want to be them or to be like them? Maybe want to be with them. I think there was something about watching the band that night and other times that made art seem like an impossible talent. I've always been mesmerized by effortlessness or the illusion thereof. They traded instruments throughout the night. Here's the drummer on guitar singing a slow one. Here's the bassist bashing away on the keyboard. What I longed for wasn't to be them, which seemed impossible, and you could cut and paste some essay on representation in here, but there wasn't any sense of melancholy on my part at the time. Maybe my imagination was just sealed off, but it wasn't necessarily stifled. I never aspired to be on stage. I wanted to find a community in the crowd. I wanted the other fans, these three girls, to recognize that I was one of them. That I understood why they felt compelled to shout along, even if I chose not to. I went to shows not to imagine myself as a star, but to share in the marvel, to study different expressions of devout faith. This is the last one. It's Eugene. A few months ago, my cousin Eugene asked me to sell off his music collection for him. There's nothing wrong with him unless you think someone mad for wanting to get rid of hundreds of CDs and records it took decades to assemble. But he's rented the same small apartment in Soho since the 90s, maximizing its acute angles, balancing things on ledges above head, ever aware of how much a cubic foot of real estate in Lower Manhattan costs. It was time to move on. One day I came home and my living room was filled with boxes of CDs and LPs. I'd helped liberate a few boxes of Eugene's records a few years back, absorbing some 90s LPs I never thought I'd find in the process. This was the rest of it. And I felt faint flipping through them. Thousands of dollars worth of CDs, probably worth pennies now. Vestiges of 90s record collecting. bootleg concert CDs, which cost $24.99 at least, box sets, which promise the mastery of an entire genre in an object the size of a hardcover novel. Back when you read about a new artist or album before you could hear it. Back when you never knew if you could hear it again. I opened a Tom Waits CD and there was a note from his brother wishing him a Merry Christmas. Back when a song was a gift. Most importantly, it was back when the most normal thing in the world was to allot some money to spend on music. This didn't make you a fiend or a fanatic, just someone who wanted to hear something old or new. You weren't curating, you just wanted to hear music at a time when this was still a novel thing to do. Now, this isn't to romanticize back then the historical period we might delineate as the 80s and 90s. Maybe it's to romanticize a different back then, back when I was still piecing my personality together. I amassed so much music, hopeful that out of this pile of things, I could chisel out some sense of self. As I acquired more and more, I began listening like a DJ, finding breaks or transitions. I began listening like a reviewer, attempting to monetize my passion by cramming through dozens of albums to see what would allow for a good riff or a joke. I'm not sure I listened to things for fun so much as I listened out of a sense of utility. We learn how to listen by watching others, and I learned a lot by watching Eugene. In the early 2000s, I was in New York, and I remember one weekend when I was on a post-breakup bender, crashing with him. I woke up on his sofa, surrounded by his jazz collection. Eugene was a designer, and he was at his desk working, and listening to Avril Lavigne's Complicated. The song ended, and then the next song came on, and it was Avril Lavigne's Complicated. And he proceeded to listen to it about 150 more times in one sitting. I was astounded and a little disturbed. He said he liked to listen to one thing while working on a project. I watched him and realized that I'd probably never felt this way, wanting to hear something over and over that many times. I remember this episode as I was sorting through Eugene's CDs a few months ago. I thought it would be very hard to get rid of this stuff. It was easy to flip his records, but nobody really wants CDs anymore. I went through the boxes, sorted them, and realized he collected a lot of live concert bootlegs. There was an entire box of live CDs by Van Morrison, The Talking Heads, Robin Hitchcock, and Elvis Costello. There were live bootlegs of Tori Amos, The Counting Crows, The Dave Matthews Band. I'd text him about some live Miles Davis CD, and he'd reply with some description of something that happens 20 minutes into the second disc. I'd ask about an REM CD, and he'd tell me about having once been in this circle of obsessive REM bootleg concert tape traders. And then there was this. John Cage.
I think you all know this one. It's a very old one. 11 years old now.
There's a bootleg of the Cranberries. And you can hear the banter as Dolores O'Riordan settles on stage, the crowd's surging awe once a sound becomes recognizable as a hit song. You sense the band feeding off the crowd as they dance their favorites. And I texted Eugene. He remembered O'Riordan sounding, quote, a little pitchy on the CD. I asked him why he had so many bootlegs. It took me a long time to realize that this is an excellent song. And he told me that his parents, my aunt and uncle, were very strict when he and his brother were growing up, and they never let him go to concerts as a teenager. But he loved music so much, he always wanted to understand what it was like to see them play, to pretend he was there too. So he would save up and buy live CDs, and he would imagine he was in the crowd with everyone else. I wanted to do the same. I wanted to listen the way Eugene listened, to become so enraptured as a fan that I'd sit and listen to Linger over and over and over. It seemed so novel, after going to so many concerts all these years, shows that disturbed or provoked me, at which I sang along or swayed, or at one Sonic Youth show during a late 90s finals week, somehow fell asleep standing up, to have this new archive of live experiences I never had. some I would have never thought to have. But I could hear in the crowd awe, the random voice yelling from an obscure B-side, the disembodied shrieks. I heard something familiar, so I decided to keep all of his CDs. Thanks, everyone.